Good morning, everybody, and welcome to a special weekend edition. Happy St. Patrick's Day. Vodcast by Mr. Mahan. Today's Vodcast is going to look at this idea of limiting and excess reactant. If you have not watched the Vodcast on dimensional analysis and, more importantly, stoichiometry, some of the topics as we get into the actual math part of these problems may seem foreign to you. So it's suggested that if you have yet to watch those, maybe you should. Okay, so let's get into it. So first, what we're going to do is we're going to cover the concept of limiting reactant versus excess reactant, and then we're going to get into actually how to solve them for the chemistry reasons or for the reasons for you that you will be using it in this chemistry course. So the first scenario I'm going to give you is imagine if you were at a cookout or imagine you're at a barbecue, whatever you want to call it, and you had 80 hamburger patties and 60 hamburger buns, and assume that, the 60 buns is 60 tops and 60 bottoms. My question to you would be, how many single patty burgers can you make? And then on top of that, which would you run out of first? And so if you think about it, you could only make 60 what we're going to call hamburger sandwiches. Considering that even though I have enough burgers for 80, I have 80 burger patties, single patty sandwiches, one patty for one sandwich. That would give me, I have enough burger patties to make 80 sandwiches. However, I only have enough buns to make 60 sandwiches. So even though my burgers are saying, hey, let's go for 80, my buns are saying I can only do 60 and then I'm going to be used up. So to answer our second question here, the fact that we would run out of the buns first, that is what's limiting the number of sandwiches I can make. Again, even though my burger patties are ready for 80, my buns are already ready for 60, and so I'm going to run out of them first. So because we would run out of those buns first, we call the buns the limiting reactant in the case of hamburger patties versus hamburger buns. Okay. Now, at first glance, that might not really make too much sense, but if you think about it, in our previous discussions in class, I've been saying that balanced chemical equations are almost like recipes. They're almost very similar to formulas that you would use. In order to make 20 pancakes, you need 2 eggs, 1 cup of milk, a tablespoon of this, a teaspoon, whatever. Well, here we go again. Here's our formula. Here's our recipe that I have. One burger patty plus one burger bun equals one burger sandwich. Now, yes, I know this sandwich has a lot more going on than just the meat and bread, but we're using that, just using this visual to help you understand that the burger patties and the burger buns are our reactants in this scenario. So, more importantly, what does it mean to be a limiting reactant? The limiting reactant is going to be the reactant that you run out of, the reactant that will be completely used up, the reactant that after you add your patties and your buns or your calcium and your oxygen or your magnesium and your chlorine or whatever to, whichever reactant is actually going to be used up. Now, the thing to keep in mind here is that it's not necessarily the reactant that you start with less of. In this case, yes, I had 80 burger patties and 60 buns, and 60 is less than 80. So you're going to look at it right away and say, okay, duh, Mr. Mahan, 60 is less than 80. And I would agree with you. But you can't necessarily just pick the reactant that you have a lower value of to begin with. And we're going to look at why in our next example. All right. So our limiting reactant is a reactant that's going to be completely used up, that there's not going to be any left over of. And because it's used up, it limits the amount of product that can be made. So just like we had enough patties to make 80 sandwiches, since I'm going to run out of buns, the buns are limiting how many sandwiches I can make. Okay, the buns are limiting how many sandwiches I can make. So it is the reactant that is limiting, aka the limiting reactant. Now, I just said that it's not necessarily always the number that's less. And you're going to say again to me, well, Mr. Mahan, 60 is less than 80, so duh, the 60 buns is the limiting reactant. Well, let's look at that same scenario, but rather now, instead of making those single patty burgers, what if I made it to make double patties? What if I wanted to make double burgers? Well, again, I ask you, how many sandwiches can you make and how many would you run out of? In our first example, since I had 80 burger patties and I was making single sandwiches, I could make 80 sandwiches as far as my patties were considered. But now that I'm making double patty sandwiches, now I can only make 40 sandwiches. Okay, and now we see the opposite. Even though I have enough buns to make 60, just like I did in the single example, I only have enough burgers to make 40. So again, even though my buns are ready to go for 60, my sandwiches are only sitting there. My patties are sitting there saying, listen, I can only make 40. So this time we would run out of the burgers first, and so this time the limiting reactant is not the buns. In fact, the limiting reactant are the patties. And the reason why I made this example is because take a look here now. I actually started with 80 patties, but they're the thing I'm going to run out of first. I started with 80 patties, which is more than 60, but my 80 patties are my limiting reactant because I'm running out of the patties first. Okay, so you can't take these initial values at face value and say, oh, okay, this is what's going to be, whichever of these is less is the limiting reactant. That's not necessarily always the case. So we have this idea of a limiting reactant, the reactant that we have left over of, the reactant that we have extra of, the reactant that we maybe have an excess of, we call that an excess reactant. Okay, so if I'm going to make chocolate chip cookies, and I only have enough cookie dough to make 24 cookies, but I have enough chocolate chips to make 50 cookies, those extra chips I've left over, they are the excess. So in the first scenario, I ran out of buns first, so my burgers would have been the excess reactant. In my first case, I would have had 20 burger patties left over ready to be cooked. Okay. In the second scenario, we would have run out of the burgers first, and so I would have still had 20 buns left over, so our excess reactant in the second one would be the buns. All right, so basically, the limiting reactant is the reactant you're going to run out of first. The other reactant or reactants are the excess reactant or excess reactants. They're the ones we're going to have left over. Now, that's a very nice conceptual question. Perhaps some of you guys, maybe you've ever had cookouts or barbecues or whatever at your house. You've had this scenario. You've had more buns left over than patties or more patties left over than buns. But let's now try and bring this back to chemistry. So just like what we did there where we had to look at our product and look at, okay, how much can I make of my product? How much does this one reactant make of my product? The burger patties can make 80 sandwiches. The buns can make 60 sandwiches. Well, we have to do the same thing in chemistry, but instead of asking how many sandwiches can we make, we're gonna ask how many moles, okay? We're gonna ask how many moles of product can I make. So, basically, essentially, what's gonna happen here, and what's really gonna give this away, is that we're gonna end up with two little mini two-step stoichiometry problems. I'm gonna have two givens, and so I'm gonna end up with two mini stoichiometry problems. After I do my stoichiometry problems, the reactant that will produce less moles, not less miles, but less moles, the reactant that produces less moles, we're going to go back and call that reactant the limiting reactant, and the reactant that is ready to produce more moles is the excess reactant. Now, at first glance, this slide still doesn't make too much sense, so we're going to look at an example problem. But essentially, guys, we're doing the exact same thing we just did with the burger scenario. Okay, how many sandwiches can my patties make? How many sandwiches can my buns make? When we compared them, the one that produced less sandwiches was the limiting reactant. The one that produced more sandwiches was the excess reactant. All right, so here's a more realistic example problem that you will see in our class. So here I tell you, if you have 25 grams of hydrogen gas and it's going to react with the 25 grams, or I'm sorry, with the 33.1 grams of nitrogen, my question to you is, what are the limiting and excess reactants? Well, my question to you is, which are we going to run out of first, and which are we going to have left over of? So first thing I want to draw your attention to is, here's for the first time in any of our dimensional analysis or stoichiometry type problems, we now have two givens. So again, these two givens have to be saying to you, whoop, 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 red alert, red alert, red alert. Two givens, two-step stoich problems. Now again, in order to do this, I'm going to need a balanced chemical equation. I need to know, what's my recipe? What's my formula? Is it one burger patty plus one bun is one sandwich? Is it two burger patties plus one bun is one sandwich? What's my ratio here? What's my formula? So the balanced chemical formula is 1 mole of nitrogen gas will react with 3 moles of hydrogen gas to produce 2 moles of ammonia, NH3. So now that I know what my reaction is, now that I know what my formula is, now that I know what my recipe is, now I have a product. So now I know how I can compare, how I can in fact compare these two reactants to see who's going to produce more or who's going to produce less. So I set up my first given. I set up my second given, okay? First given being the 25 grams of H2. 25 grams of H2. Second given is going to be the 33.1 grams of N2. Now again, check it out. Two simple two-step stoic problems to get myself out of grams of reactant into moles of the product. And the big thing here, ladies and gentlemen, the big thing that I hope that you understand is that our wants here have to be identical. Just like when you thought, how many sandwiches can the patties make? How many sandwiches can the buns make? We have to ask ourselves, okay, how many moles of product can this reactant make? And how many moles of product can this reactant make? So that we can actually, in fact, compare them. And when we do the workout, we see that the 25 grams of hydrogen is ready, willing, and able to make 8.3 moles of NH3. The 33.1 grams of nitrogen is ready, willing, and able to make 2.4 moles of NH3. So just like our patties was ready to make a ton of sandwiches, but our buns was not, here it turns out that because the NH3 can only make 2.4 moles of NH3, I'm sorry, the 33.1 grams of N2 can only make the 2.4 moles of NH3. After 2.4 moles of product are made, that's it. I'm going to be out of my nitrogen. So I actually say over here that my nitrogen is my LR, or my limiting reactant, because it is going to limit how much product I can in fact make. That would then make my hydrogen up here my excess reactant, because I'm going to have some of it left over. So the trick here, ladies and gentlemen, two givens, two mini, two-step stoichiometry problems to see how many moles of a product, and that product has to be consistent, how many moles of a product I can in fact produce. After I figure out how many moles each makes, the one that makes less, I go back to that reactant and identify that reactant as the limiting reactant, and the leftover reactant, the one that will produce more moles, to be the excess reactant. And that's it. That's how simple these problems really are. The only trick is to make sure that you set your given on the left side of your paper as per the usual, and set your want to be moles of some product, and the moles have to be the same for whatever product I'm picking. I hope that this vodcast has helped you further understand limiting reactant, excess reactant conceptually, and it's possibly even helped you understand how to work these problems out. There will be another vodcast on how to solve a little bit more advanced problems for limiting reactant, excess reactant. Thank you for watching, and have a great day.